Joining me now live is former White House Chief of Staff and consultant at Bondi Partners, Mick Mulvaney. Mick, thank you so much for joining us. Why do you think the president wanted to prevent any perception that the US had something to do with the mutiny?
Well, certainly what the Russians are going to be saying is that we did. Anytime you have a foreign power that's in trouble, they're going to try and blame those issues on folks outside of that country. So my guess is the Biden administration was trying to be preemptive to simply say, look, in case anybody hears we are involved, we were absolutely not involved. It's the right message for the Biden administration to deliver. It's the right message for the Australians and the Brits and the Kiwis and the Canadians, all the Five Eyes countries to deliver at the same time. So I thought it was the right move at the right time.
It's been an interesting weekend. There's certainly cracks in the Russian leadership. The mutiny is over for now. But what impact could this have on the US and its allies?
It's a really good question. Again, the American commitment to the war remains strong and will remain strong as long as the Europeans remain committed to the war. And I'm not just talking about the British now. I'm talking about the French and the Germans especially. So I don't see this development forcing the Europeans to waver at all. If anything, it may reaffirm their commitment to Europe because they may feel like they're close to winning this battle against Russia. So I don't think this negatively impacts American involvement, and it may just simply reinforce it slightly.
All right, let's move on now. Let's talk about 2024. You've written an article claiming that Donald Trump has a math problem. What do you mean by this?
That actually grew out of a conversation I had with a very high-ranking Republican in a swing state of Georgia. He's a friend of mine. I asked him over the last weekend, I said, do you think Trump could win Georgia? And he said, absolutely not. And he went on to tell me why. He said that in the last election, Donald Trump said some really nasty things about some very popular Republicans. Brian Kemp, the governor there, won by 10 or 12 points. He and the president are not on good terms. And the President Trump was actually, it sounded like, was trying to help the Democrat beat the Republican for the governor's race. That's the type of thing that people don't forget. And if you're a Republican, you have to win Georgia in order to win the White House. So if Donald Trump cannot win Georgia, he cannot win the White House. We're hearing the same stories, Danica, about out of Arizona and out of Nevada as well, that Donald Trump has just worn out his welcome in these critical swing states. So while you still may see some national polling that shows him ahead of Joe Biden, when you break it down into the states that Donald Trump has to win, he has a math problem right now.
So where do you think that Donald Trump, should he be successful as a candidate, where do you think he'll be campaigning in the lead up to 2024?
Well, he better be campaigning in Iowa, New Hampshire, South Carolina, because those are the early states. And if he shows any weakness there, then he's going to have some real trouble. Now, when you go fast forward into the general election, assuming that Donald Trump is the Republican nominee, you're going to see him spending a lot of time in Georgia, a lot of time in Arizona. Annalise, your U.S. Representative, will be in Nevada a good bit. Those are the same swing states that Trump would have to win that he lost 3 years ago.
Yeah, look, it's going to be really interesting to see how it plays out. And then, of course, on the Democratic side of things, we've got Robert F. Kennedy Jr., his nomination. Can he at all count on his famous family for support to take on Biden, do you think?
No, he can't. And I think it's, I feel sort of bad for him because anytime you do something like this, you want to have the support of your family. Look, Robert F. Kennedy probably doesn't have a chance to be the Democrat nominee. He's not, he's what in America we call a stalking horse. I don't know if that translates into Australian English or not. But other Democrats are looking to him as to whether or not there's any weakness for Biden. So if you're a governor of California, if you're a very popular, say, senator in Washington, D.C., and a Democrat, you don't want to be the person to sort of go after Joe Biden because he's the leader of the Democrat Party. But if Robert Kennedy starts getting 25, 30, 35% of the polling data, it will indicate a weakness that Biden has, and you'll see other Democrats get in the race. So I don't think Robert F. Kennedy has a chance to beat Joe Biden, but he might be the person who opens the door for someone else to challenge the sitting president.
What about that famous surname of his? Do you think that that will translate to voters?
You know, I wish that it did, because his nephew, Joe Kennedy, is a good friend of mine. Joe ran for senator 2 years back and got famously beaten very bad. So while the name is still solid gold, there's no question about it. The days of being able to rely on just the Kennedy name. Keep in mind, that race was just in Massachusetts. You would think the Kennedy name would be huge in that state, if nowhere else. So while the name certainly gets some attention, we're talking about him in large part because his last name is Kennedy, it doesn't really translate into votes like it would have a generation ago.
Another fascinating week. Mick Mulvaney, we'll leave it there. Thank you for joining us.